Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2021. I'd like to ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting, including on your surfaces if you're using those, your computers. Agenda item one, I'd like to invite the committee to take items 11 and 12 in private. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Agenda item two is the panel on housing and planning. And the first item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of the committee's work on priorities in session six. We will take evidence on housing and planning matters from a round table of witnesses this morning. And I welcome to the committee Craig McLaren, the director of Scotland, Ireland and English Regions Royal Town Planning Institute, Claire Simmons, Chair of Planning Democracy, Stacey Dingwall, Senior Policy Manager of the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, Callum Chomshuk, National Director of the Chartered Institute of Housing, Eleanor Folkson, National Chair of Living Rent, Nicola Barclay, the Chief Executive of Homes for Scotland, and Tony Kane, Policy Manager from the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers. Thank you all for joining us today, and thank you for the information you provided to the committee in advance of today's meetings. So we will move straight to questions, and before we do that, I just wanted to give you a little bit of guidance around how we're going to work this. So what will happen is that members will ask a question, and they will, if they remember to, they will direct their question to one or two people initially. If you want to come in on that question, please put an R in the chat box to indicate that you want to do that, and we'll bring you in. And I just want to run through the theme so you're aware. We've got quite a mixed panel here, and so it may be that some of the themes we're covering don't necessarily pertain to your area. So the first theme is housing, which is going to be focusing on tenants' rights, homelessness, and housing quality. Then the second theme is funding and resourcing of planning departments. Theme three is the Scottish Government budget. Theme four is planning in general. Theme five is net zero emission homes. And theme six is sustainable communities and placemaking. So just so you're aware of where we're going in our journey this morning. So I'd like to invite Eleanor Whittam to start with theme one.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to everybody on the panel. Welcome along to this morning. And before I get started and ask my question, I would just like to refer members to my register of interest. I'm still a serving councillor in East Ayrshire Council. So I'm going to explore some issues in theme one, which is, as Ariane said, surrounding tenants' rights, homelessness and housing quality. The first question that I would like to explore, and I'll direct this to Eleanor from Living Rent if I can, is whether the panel agrees that tenants' rights need to be improved and what they would like to see in the Scottish Government's forthcoming rented sector strategy. So if I could hear from Eleanor first, and then if anybody else wants to come in after that, if you put R in the chat, please.
Eleanor,
thank you.
Apparently Eleanor is not there.
Oh, I've just been advised that Eleanor is not with us yet. So I'm going to direct this question to Tony Kane from Alacho. Tony, if you don't mind kicking off this morning, thank you.
Absolutely not. Thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me along on behalf of Alacho this morning. I think our view is yes, that tenants' rights need to be strengthened in a range of areas. And our submission, for example, to this committee's predecessor committee on the 2016 Act in relation to private tenants was pretty clear on that. We think the grounds for possession are too broad. We think the protections for tenants from unlawful eviction are ineffective. Largely, and we also think that students renting from specialist providers and indeed their own institutions ought to have better statutory protection than they do. And the 2016 Act actually stripped away the protection that a lot of tenants used to have under the previous legislation. So I don't think there's any doubt that there is a significant need to improve protections for tenants, certainly in the private rented sector. I think there's still work to get done to examine the way in which social landlords engage with tenants, particularly on issues around rent setting as well. So our view is that there is a substantial change yet required, I think, to bring our rented sector to a place where it would meet our ambitions, if you like, in terms of the human right to adequate housing, particularly in relation to security of tenants.
Thank you very much for that, Tony. Do we have anybody else that's indicated to come in on that one at the moment? No? Okay, I'm going to move on to my second question. And I'll direct this to Stacey from SFHA, if that's okay. How have tenants been affected by the pandemic? Are you concerned about increases in arrears and potential increases in eviction action and homelessness? And if so, are there any further protections that the Scottish Government needs to consider? And if anybody else wants to come in after Stacey, please press R in your chat. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me along today on behalf of SFHA. Throughout the pandemic, our members have worked really hard, closely with Scottish Government and other partners, to make sure that their tenants are protected as much from the pandemic as they could have been, you know, through providing access and funds and distributing that on behalf of the Scottish Government. So they have really, as I said, really worked hard to make sure that the brunt of those kind of impacts have been mitigated where possible. In terms of rent arrears, I think the data that was collected by the Scottish Housing Regulator over the last 18 months has shown that, thankfully, rent arrears, what we might have thought would happen at the start pandemic, the situation hasn't been as bad as we might have predicted. But you know, we are continuing to monitor that information through the Social Housing Resilience Group as we come out of the pandemic to make sure that there's not an impact. Our members also, in terms of rent increases over the last year, many of the associations froze them or set them at lower levels than they otherwise might have. So they have been very conscious of the impact on tenants throughout this. Again, we have to wait and see how things go over the coming months in terms of whether any other support needs to be provided to tenants.
Thank you very much for that. And I'm hearing that, Tony, you want to come in as well?
Just to add a little bit to that, I think it is the case that many tenants have struggled with rent, and they've faced the same range of problems that everybody else has during the lockdown period. But it's not universal across the rented sector. So I think it's absolutely clear that there are relatively few tenants in the social rented sector who now have arrears attributable solely to COVID that would put their tenancy at risk, and there's an opportunity to work with those tenants who have fallen behind to secure their tenancies and get them back on track in paying their rent. It's a much more complicated picture in the private rented sector, and I think there are a substantial number of tenants who have run up significant rent arrears, and we are seeing an increase in the number of private landlords looking to terminate tenancies. So it's, and in that context, I mean, we were very much involved in the conversations with the Scottish Government around the Tenant Grant Fund, and we welcome that. We think that's an important addition to the tools that we have to prevent homelessness, and our expectation is that most of those resources will be used saving private rented sector tenancies rather than the social sector.
Thanks very much for that, Tony. I've got Callum that wants to come in, and then I think Stacey wants to come back in. Callum?
Thanks, Eleanor. Yeah, the one group of tenants I'd like to speak about are kind of women in particular. So the CIH over the last few years worked quite closely with Scottish Women's Aid to look at the gender nature of homelessness. And in the last Parliament, quite a lot of work was done enacting legislation and work independently, a group looking at recommendations to improve the experience of women at risk and women experiencing homelessness. And I think from our perspective, it would be very helpful for the committee to explore how these recommendations are actually taking effect. Might be aware legislation passed in March this year probably won't come into effect till the end of next year, if not 2 years' time, which actually will help protect women and their tenancies, protecting them from homelessness. So I think any investigation looks at not just the policies that have been put in place, but the practices actually being developed on the ground and how actually women's homelessness, domestic abuse policies, and a whole range of measures are being placed to look at the gender nature of homelessness would be really welcome.
Thank you very much for bringing that up, Callum. That was actually a question I specifically had for you later on, but you've already brought it onto the table, so that's good. Good that you've got it there. And I might come back to you before I come to the end of my questions to explore that a little bit further. Can we go to Stacey? Did Stacey want to come back in? Yes.
Thank you. Just to follow up on what Tony alluded to in his answer to the first question, I think it's just important to make the distinction between the experience of private and social rented sector tenants, especially over the last 18 months. SVHA published a briefing a couple of months ago which outlined all the work that our members have done and continue to do to support tenants who have incurred arrears as a result of the pandemic. And it's certainly the case that none of our members would look to evict someone. It's definitely a last resort in terms of the support that they provide to tenants before it gets to that stage. So again, I think it's just important to look at the tenant, two different sets of tenants, and make that distinction.
Thanks very much for that, Stacey. And I understand that we have Eleanor from Living Rent now on the call. If I can maybe direct that question and what Eleanor would perhaps like to see the Scottish in the Scottish Government's forthcoming rented sector strategy for the protection of tenants as well. Eleanor, if you want to. She's not quite there yet. Okay, we'll come back to that. Sorry about that. Right, my next question is going to be surrounding what progress, so it's a kind of a health check, thinking about the progress that's been made with the Ending Homelessness Together Action Plan and the implementation of Council's Rapid Rehousing Action Plans. And I'm going to direct this question first off to Tony from Malacho. If you can come in about that, please. Thank you.
My apologies, I think I missed the first.
Oh my God, we lost everybody.
Hello?
Hi, I can hear you now.
So I think
can...
I missed the first part of the question.
Right, I'm just looking for a health check, your sense about how we are progressing with the Ending Homelessness Together Action Plans and also the Rapid Rehousing Action Plans. I think we might need.
Okay, so we're just going to suspend the meeting briefly just to check out their technical challenges here.
Yeah, I'm not sure this is my link.
Be operated from there. Okay. Can you hear me okay now? Testing, testing. Nodding heads. All right. Yes. Great. Good. Thank you for that. Okay. So we are going to resume if you just want to pick up with your questions. Yeah.
Okay. I'll try that again. Tony, I was looking for you to start us off with what how you feel about the progress that's been made with the Ending Homelessness Together Action Plan and the implementation of Council's Rapid Rehousing Action Plans. Thank you.
Cool. I think you have to acknowledge that the pandemic last year has certainly knocked us off course. So we've seen over the period since March last year a significant increase in the number of people in temporary accommodation, difficulties in preparing empty properties for reuse has held us back in housing a number of folks. So we probably lost 20% of the supply of empty properties last year as a consequence. And we are still struggling across the social sector to bring voids back into use because there are now difficulties in organising the work, in getting the workforce in place, but also in supplies and materials. So we have been held back by the pandemic, but I think setting that aside, councils have made excellent progress in understanding what's required around rapid rehousing transition plans, in developing support and engagement frameworks for those at risk of homelessness, but also in working with colleagues in the housing association sector to ensure that more homes are available for homeless people. I think one of the big challenges remains having sufficient resources to provide support that's required, but also critically that the interface with colleagues in health, particularly services around drugs, alcohol and mental health, still isn't working fully effectively. And I have, again, in front of the predecessor committee to this one on a number of occasions to say that there were significant issues with the effectiveness of community-based services on drugs, alcohol and mental health, and those issues largely remain in place, although work is clearly underway to address that. It's still a major issue. And we haven't cracked the issues around community justice and those associated with homelessness arising from liberation from custody, either from prison or from remand sentence, or indeed from police custody on occasion. So the understanding of the issues is good. Some of the joint working has improved. Some of the gaps remain as they were. But the commitment to the sector, and I think increasingly the commitment to colleagues in the housing association sector, remains strong. Everybody understands that ending homelessness should be a priority for us.
Thanks very much for that, Tony. And you have brought in the RSL sector and housing association. So if we could hear from Stacey, perhaps, on SFHA's perspective on how they play a partnership role in the Ending Homelessness Together Action Plan. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I would support a lot of what Tony said there in terms of over the course of the last 18 months, there has been a real commitment to provide as many homes as we can. It's not been easy, just in terms of kind of the issues that Tony's highlighted there in terms of turning around void properties, particularly at the beginning of the year. There was a lot of issues in terms of work. We had to work with energy suppliers through the Social Housing Resilience Group because there was a bit of a hold-up in terms of properties being made available because of that. And certainly now, when we are beginning to see the real impact of issues with access to, you know, the supply chain, access to materials and labour, that is having a real impact in terms of, you know, being able to bring the houses up to the quality in order to let them out to people who need them. So it's just a real shame at the moment that these things are having an impact on people being able to get into the homes that they need. But yes, certainly we see ourselves having a strong role within at that table. We have quite a lot of links, not just with councils, but you know, with homelessness partners as well. SFHA, we have strategic partnerships there, particularly in terms of Housing First, in order that we can work with our members to make available more properties through Housing First.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to hand back over to the convener because my time's up now. Thank you.
Thank you, Eleanor. And now we're going to move on to our second theme, which is funding and resourcing of planning departments. And I invite Miles to start us off with that.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. During the evidence which we've been taking, we've heard, I think, unanimously from the views which we've sought around our planning departments not necessarily being in a good place. We've heard that nearly a third of planning departments have seen staff cuts since 2009. We've seen diminishings in real terms by 42%, in fact, over that period. So I wanted to ask the panel, in your opinion, how do you think planning departments are currently functioning in Scotland and what needs to be done to tackle some of the challenges? So could I maybe start with Nicola Barclay, then Craig McLaren, and if anyone wanted to put an R in the chat, bring you in after that.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you for letting me come and speak to the panel today. Miles, you hit on a really challenging problem that we have. I'm obviously here representing the house building industry, who are one of the largest customers of the planning system. And we have seen a real challenge getting consents through the system, not just planning departments, also building control, roads officers. Planning is part of a system. but the planning professionals themselves pursuing these consents have been really struggling. I know through COVID, a lot of them were moved off to do other work to support their colleagues. But if the aspiration of the country is to increase the supply of new homes, which is very clear it is, we need to make sure that the planning departments are well resourced. And it's not just about making sure those people who are currently in post stay there, but we need to be attracting more people into the industry, more people into this profession. And I'm sure Craig will have more detail on what universities can be doing or are doing to encourage more people into this really fundamental profession to make sure we've got a pipeline of talent coming through. In terms of cost, yes, we have an issue where we pay significant money for planning applications, but that money is not automatically ring-fenced to deliver the service. Councils need to use that money for other things, and they will do so. And I think that's a real challenge for local authorities when they have tight budgets. How do you best use that money? But I do fundamentally believe that planning fees should be ring-fenced for delivering the service that customers effectively are paying for. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Nicola. And if Craig, do you want to come in on that? And then that'll be followed by Claire and Callum.
Yeah, thanks very much. And thanks to the committee for inviting me to come along today on behalf of RTPI. I think you've hit on a very, very key issue. I think our planning departments are in a very precarious position just now, verging on a crisis, to be honest with you. You've heard the figures. I think we've seen over the last, since 2009, certainly since we've been tracking resourcing, the real decrease in the amount of staff in planning departments and the budgets which they have as well. This also seems to be the department which has taken the biggest hit through this period in terms of budgets. So it's something which is which needs to be addressed specifically towards planning. I think the issue we have here is not just where we are just now with the reductions we've seen in staff and budgets, but also what's coming down the line. The Planning Act, 2019 Planning Act, it contains a number of new duties which will have to be taken up by planning authorities. A very large majority of them are unfunded. Research we've undertaken has shown that that could lead to a need for between £12 and £59 million. We've also seen research which was commissioned by Skills Development Scotland saying that with all the demands which are going to be put on planners in the next 10 to 15 years, things around tackling zero carbon, trying to reach zero carbon targets, around implementing the Planning Act, and all the different things which have to be done to ensure we get more housing in place as well. It's shown that there's a demand for at least another 700 planners over the next 10 to 15 years as well. And that's an additional, not just catching up what we've got already. So there's a demand which is growing as well for new planners. So there's a need to try and think about how we resource the system just now by seeing how fees can be reinvested within the system. There's a need to try and make sure we have planning fees actually cover the costs of actually undertaking the processing of planning application. Currently, just now, they only cover about 2/3 of costs. And we need to start to think about how we can, as Nicola said, how we can make sure that we promote planning as a career and we get people into it. And we have been trying that for a number of years. But I think there's something needed at a national level to try and make sure that planning and planners is seen as an attractive career option and that there are different routes into the profession. We are keen to explore the idea of a planning apprenticeship, for example. There's quite a lot to be done. There's quite an issue to be faced here and now, but also in the future.
Thank you. And Claire, and then Callum.
Hello, panel, and thanks for inviting me to come and give evidence today. I guess the impact of funding cuts is that planning authorities tend to end up doing just what's required of them by law. And to be honest, that's a little bit limited. And the real casualties, I think, are community engagement and enforcement. One of the big things we see in the planning democracy mailbag is, you know, the lack of enforcement of conditions. And, you know, conditions minimise the negative impacts of development on communities and on the environment. But regularly we're hearing that they're not, you know, they're being ignored sometimes with impunity. And developers know that planning conditions are often not enforced, and I think that doesn't help. So conditions are a way of building trust with the communities. You know, they show that the system can respond to their concerns and is prepared to alleviate some of the impacts. if they don't get enforced, that sends a very negative message to the community. I think some research has been done on this by the University of the West of England into the lack of monitoring of compliance or conditions. So I could send that to the panel if you wish. The second mailbag issue for Planning Democracy is the quality of the poor quality of environmental reports and ecology reports. You know, funding for planning needs to take into account the related services, such as ecological expertise, particularly if you're going to achieve the biodiversity net gain targets that are now required as an outcome of National Planning Framework 4. So that we know that planning departments and planners have been cut, but also local government ecologists have been cut, and research has shown that this leads to variable and often poor quality ecological reports being received by planners. And certainly our anecdotal evidence backs this up. You know, we've got examples where communities put in phenomenal effort and have found that important habitats and species are present but haven't been recorded. You know, this could be priority habitats and so on. You know, impacts on SSSIs downstream and scheduled monuments and have been absent from reports provided by developers. Importantly, also carbon-rich soils identified by community ecologists haven't made their way into the developers' report. And all this leaves communities fighting a rearguard action of, you know, multiple failings beyond their control. And it strikes us as a bit mad, actually, that the most of the current expertise that feeds into planning decisions is actually provided by the applicant themselves. But the in-house capacity to interpret and scrutinise those reports is really lacking. And there's a huge source of frustration and anger to in communities. But on a more, I guess, positive note, you know, work being done on biodiversity net gain, the methodology around that, and also on the Scottish Nature Network, which is proposed as one of the local, the national developments. You know, that's clearly going to require more resources. I think about 100 jobs, over 32 local authorities are required. But these are the kind of jobs we want. You know, this is about greening of the economy and a green recovery. So that's really important. Two more things I'd just like to mention. One is about funding for public-led planning. We're hoping to see a bit more public-led planning in the National Planning Framework in order to help deliver on affordable housing targets. And that really needs to be properly funded, really properly funded. And then my final comment on meeting some of the resource issues through fee increases. Well, you know, as Nicola said, you know, in this world that we're in now, the chief customer is seen to be the developer, and it leaves the community stakeholders behind. And I think, you know, if you're going to get all your increases, your funding from fee increases, then I think you've really got to consider who, you know, where that's going, because there will be an expectation that the system works better for the developers rather than communities. And so maybe it is about finding alternative sources of funding for those kind of services. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. And so let's move to Callum, and then Craig wants to come back in.
Thank you. I just in response to Mel's question, I wonder if we could just broaden it out just a little bit, because while I think we're absolutely right to focus about planning, the housing sector at large has we need to look at the kind of professionalism, the education succession planning across the entire housing sector. As Nicola said, we don't want to look at one profession as narrowness. And I think when we have a hugely ambitious agenda around housing in 2040, which I know the committee will consider, I think what is missing from that ambition that's there, and it's a really welcome ambition, is a focus on the people who are delivering it, the people who are going to be building the homes, the people who are going to be managing the services, the housing professionals that we're going to need to deliver on this 20-year strategy. And I think the fact we don't have kind of clear pipelines for people into the housing sector, either from college, necessarily college, school, university, or out of the other sectors, we've got an ageing profession as well. And how are we going to manage that? If we're going to meet the ambitions of housing in 2040, how are we going to manage that? And I think having a more proactive relationship with the government and skills development and the sector, we're absolutely instrumental in delivering on the ambitions of housing in 2040. But I'd implore the committee to kind of reflect on that, as well as looking at the considerations of the planning department, which are, you know, absolutely worthy as well.
Thank you, Callum. That's a very good point that, yes, we are wondering ourselves. So if Craig wants to come back in, and then Nicola.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, convener. I just wanted to follow up something which Claire had said around public-led planning. I think one of the poster boys of the Planning Act was the idea of having local police plans, which was which we think a really, really good way of trying to make sure that communities can be involved in a very positive and constructive way about how they can shape the future of their place or the town or city which or neighbourhood which they're within. They are really could be really interesting and quite game changing, I think. One of the issues we have with that is there are no resources allocated to make sure that those are funded properly. The communities are given the money to take that forward so that they can work with planning professionals and others to have a look at what the opportunities of their area is, but also what the constraints are, and to try and to build that vision for what that place looks like and then that route map to try and make sure that happens. So that's a big ask, I think, and if there's no resource pushed towards that, I think it could be something which means we don't manage to get that more community-led, community-involved planning, which I think we all want.
Thank you for that point. And Nicola.
Thank you. I just wanted to come back on something that Claire said as well about the reports which developers submit to, with their planning applications, and this is a legal requirement for them to do so. And they are equally frustrated that the councils, when they receive the reports, often don't actually have the skills in-house to be able to reflect on them and then respond. And what unfortunately happens is that those planning applications just get parked. They sit and they're delayed for months on end because nobody has the skill set to make a decision with the information in front of them. And we also have to remember that the planning officers within a council are not making decisions in isolation of their other colleagues. They rely on people within the education department to tell them what school capacity is like. And education departments have been struggling to cope with these requests internally when they have got other pulls on their time. Roads departments, again, they have to provide a road construction consent. If they haven't had the opportunity to comment on an application when it is live, by the time they get to do their road construction consent, they often are not happy with the layout and are asking developers to go back and change the layout to their own requirements. So we have to remember that we need a joined up approach within councils. So they have to be well resourced, have an attitude of wanting to help each other to get their jobs done. So whether it's to help your planning colleague, whether it's to help the roads departments, bringing them all in. And we've seen some great examples within local councils where they have pre-application sessions with the developer, with all those people around the table, and those applications tend to come through the system smoothly, as you would expect. Unfortunately, that's not happening right across the country with each council.
Thank you for that, Nicola. Yes, it is clear that I think there's going to be a lot of pressure on planning departments over the next 10 years, and it would be good at this point to really set a good course and make sure they're well resourced. I believe Eleanor would like to come in on this as well.
Right. First of all, thank you for inviting myself and Living Rent to give evidence before the committee. I would like to reiterate a point made by Claire Simmons earlier around the lack of democratic engagement in the planning process from the communities that a lot of these projects involve. We have heard, or a lot of our members in the union have experienced a lack of concern for how development plans in communities affect those living there. And as we are hopefully going to approach a fair transition into a greener system that will involve big both infrastructure and household projects, we think it is essential that community interests are at the heart of those projects. We also think that sort of community interests have to be prioritised over a lot of developers' interest, as we are in the long term trying to build sustainable communities or sustainable infrastructure for the communities that will live there. Thank you.
Thanks, Eleanor. And Claire, you would like to come back in? And then I'm just
going to wrap it up.
The small points, really, well, the small points with big impact, I guess. you know, the consequences of poor planning outcomes is at a real cost to society. And I think we've just got to look at the downstream impacts of poor planning decisions and poor planning. You know, it affects so much. It affects our climate, it affects the diversity, biodiversity, health and well-being, infrastructure stresses, and so on. So I think, you know, funding planning is kind of, you know, money well spent. Also, just a quick follow-up to Eleanor's point on the community engagement. You know, without resources, community engagement is always going to be a bit rubbish, isn't it? You know, it's 50 years since the Skeffington report on public engagement in planning, and we've really made very, very little progress on that. And I think that's really hardly surprising because it's not really been funded, so it's not been prioritised. And yeah, I think Greg's point about local place plans is great. They will only be worthwhile if the officers with the required expertise, and I think, you know, community development skills and stuff like that comes into that. You know, that's what needs to be funded. Thank you.
Thanks, Claire. And thank you. That was a good, quick exploration of that theme around funding and resourcing in the planning departments. We're going to move on, sticking with funding. We're going to talk a bit about the Scottish Government budget for building affordable housing, and I'm going to bring Paul McClellan in for that.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Can I just refer everyone to my register of interest? I'm still an existing councillor on East Lothian Council. The Convener mentioned, obviously, we're moving on to the theme around about the budget, and we know there are cost pressures coming through now on building homes, new homes, particularly in the last few months. The question really is, how adequate are the recently reviewed Scottish Government grant subsidy benchmarks to allow social landlords to build new homes at affordable rents? And I'll probably ask Stacey and Tony and probably Nicola to come in just after that, if that's okay, just to address that point.
Yes, thank you. Yes, SVTA was pleased to be a part of the working group which reviewed the benchmarks earlier this year. A lot of discussion went into that, a lot of evidence submitted by ourselves and other partners in the group, particularly on the point that you've raised there around the increasing costs that developing social landlords are seeing. In advance of the group, SVHA published some research which found that, on average, the cost of building a house had increased by about £20,000 in the last 5 years. That research was carried out in February and March, and unfortunately we're hearing every day from members now that those costs are only increasing and much more rapidly than they have in the last 5 years. So we continue to collect and also submit that to the government for review. We were pleased, you know, obviously, in advance of that working group with the £3.4 billion investment to affordable housing supply over the next 5 years, which was what we asked for in other research that we carried out with CIH and Shelter Scotland. But was the issue that we have now is that with one of the key aims of the Scottish Government of the review was for the majority of projects to come in at or below the benchmarks that were set within the group. And unfortunately, I think despite the evidence that, as I say, we and others submitted of what we believe that the benchmark should be, at the rate that they've currently been set at, we just have real concern whether that target will actually be able to be met in the face of the increasing costs that we're seeing just now. And just also in terms of whether it's going to have an impact on the ability to meet the 110,000 target that we now have. Just real concerns that there's not going to be enough investment in order to meet that target and provide the homes that we know people desperately need in the country.
Stacey, can I just ask a supplementary? And obviously, it's over the next 5 years, and I suppose it's what's going to come forward in the next 5 years. It's 110,000. It's not going to be almost like the 22,000 each of these years. Do you see that being impacted at all? Is it? You know, and I suppose that's one of the key things. If there are cost pressures coming through now, if we're behind in the first year, obviously, then the delivery for the next number of years after that is going to increase and it's going to become difficult. Are you seeing issues in the next, almost in the next year, 2 years, which will obviously then be proved difficult in the latter years to deliver that 110,000 and almost playing catch-up, if you like?
Yeah, and I think, yeah, that's the real concern, that we are behind just now, obviously. The previous programme, obviously, is a result of the pandemic. But, yeah, you mean, I mean, in terms of some of the, we're collecting evidence of the you know, the individual components that our members have seen cost increases in. It's up to, you know, 100%, I think, for some timber, you know, delays of 12 weeks. And that's changing and increasing every day, unfortunately. So it's really hard to predict, obviously, at the moment in terms of where that's going to go. But yeah, it's not looking good. Let's just say that.
Thank you for that. And I suppose just the same question to Tony and Nicola, and maybe open it up after that. But Tony, yourself, just the same question.
I think that it's more complicated than just the benchmark system. I mean, we've gone through a fairly complicated process to review the benchmarks and what's included in them. Some of it is new. So what does it cost to install a fire suppression system, for example? Are we clear what it's going to cost over and above a gas boiler, for example, to install heat pumps? My concern is not that the benchmarks themselves are inadequate, though they may be. That will come out as we work through the process. My concern isn't that the Scottish Government haven't made a substantial financial commitment to new social and affordable housing, because 3.4 billion by anybody's standards is a great deal of money. My concern is that we haven't made any effort to understand what the investment capacity of housing associations and councils are. We have a 10-year-old report, 12-year-old report was the last time that was looked at in detail. So the target, 110,000 as it now is, has been set entirely in a vacuum without any understanding of what that implication will be for the capacity of landlords to invest in other areas or the likely impact on rents. And rents in the social sector have been rising ahead of inflation for 40 years, but certainly for the last 20 years in order to deliver a fairly substantial investment program around condition of existing stock, but also new supply. So my concern is more that actually it now costs something in the order of £180,000 to £200,000 in mainland Scotland to build a new social rented property. It costs well over £200,000 in remote rural and island communities. £270,000 is not unusual in our island communities. And the overall budget is just not sufficient to deliver the number of homes that the Scottish Government is seeking the sector to deliver and to stay with an affordable rent. The system allows councils and housing associations to ask for the amount of money they need in order to ensure that rents remain affordable. Up until this year, council tenants, because it's tenants that pay the balance of this, have been paying 68% of the cost of a new home. 45% would be the equivalent in the social housing sector. That will change. That percentage is going to have to go down. That means the call per house on the budget from the Scottish Government is going to go up, and our chances of delivering 110,000 homes on this financial commitment within affordable rents over 10 years, or 55,000 over the next five, I think are modest. I'm not over bothered about that, in the sense that the Scottish Government's made a big commitment, and the sector will deliver as many houses as can be reasonably delivered within that. But what we haven't done is made a realistic appraisal of what we think is an affordable rent, what direction rent should be going in, what it costs to build a home, and what the capacity of the sector is to deliver. My expectation is we will get nowhere near 55,000 affordable homes in the next 5 years, and 75% of it is for the social sector, off the back of and retain affordable rents. My worry is that some landlords will be over-enthusiastic and will lose sight of the affordability question, and I think that's our bigger risk. But you know, there is no complaint in the sector about the scale of the commitment the Scottish Government has made. We just need to be realistic about what it's going to cost and how much of that can reasonably be borne by tenants in the social housing sector.
Thanks for that, Tony. Nicola, probably just a slightly different slant with yourself. I mean, obviously, your members deliver a large number of housing, and obviously there's that affordable element within that. So it's coming from a slightly different element from yourself. So, I mean, obviously 25% of nothing would be nothing. So obviously it's then looking for your member to develop housing as quickly as we can to get that affordable element. I suppose it's the same question to yourself. Obviously, the cost of house, and I know you've mentioned this before, the cost of building has gone up massively in the last number of months, particularly since Brexit. But it's also obviously around the benchmarking, so it's probably just coming from a slightly different slant from yourself, so it's the same question.
Yeah, no, I'm happy to come at it a slightly different slant. I know that Tony and Stacey are very close to the rents and the financial implications to, you know, the RSLs and to the councils on this. If I'm coming at it from the supply side, who's going to be building these homes? It's mainly our members, whether they're doing it as part of their Section 75 obligations or they're doing it as contractors as well. Many of our members have got contracting arms that are delivering these affordable homes. And what I am hearing directly from them is that they are walking away from deals that they have previously done because they cannot afford to build them. because the cost to deliver has just risen so high and there is nowhere to get that money back. And these are not, this is before we even talk about the change in building regulations, which is coming down the line to meet the net zero targets. This is today's standards that we're trying to build to. And the cost of materials, the lack of skills, the combination of the demand across the whole of the country, but the same short supply of materials is just pushing prices up. And it's a really dangerous position that we're in, that we have contractors who are looking for work, who want to keep their staff employed, are having to walk away from sites before they even put a spade in the ground because they just know that this development is underwater before we even begin. And that's not a way to run any business. So I have real concerns about whether we can actually achieve the affordable housing target at all. And that's something obviously everybody wants to do, but we need to find a way of doing it.
Nicola, just a very brief supplementary on that. Obviously, we said about the costs. Are you hearing from your members that these are longer term? I mean, obviously, there are issues around about Brexit and supply, and I've met some of your members, and they've said the same thing. Do you see this as a longer term issue, or is it something that you think it's teething problems, or is it beyond that, and this is going to be for the foreseeable future?
I think this is sustained. I think when prices go up, they very rarely come back down again. We see it on the forecourts. Petrol prices go up very quickly when the oil price goes up. Take a long time to come down again when the oil price comes down. And I think it's going to be the same across the supply chain, whether it's cement, whether it's timber, whether it's plastics. The raw materials, there's worldwide demand for these raw materials. And so if you're controlling that supply, you're going to push your prices up because that makes business sense. And we have got no control over that. And unfortunately, I'm not sure the Scottish Government has got much control over that either, as much as we would like you to.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I don't know if anybody else is wanting to come in on that one. I'll go to the second question.
Eleanor would like to come in. Eleanor, would you like to?
Yes. Thank you. Living Rent would But we believe, obviously, that there is a need for a crucial and necessary transition in housing. And I think we think this needs to address both in a new build and refurbishment of existing houses. So we really want to stress that only increasing supply of affordable housing cannot solve the current housing crisis. It also needs to include refurbishment of the existing housing stock. Like speakers that have gone before me, we also have concern about the budget I set aside for the affordable housing program. While we welcome the effort and the commitment toward building more social and affordable housing, we are concerned that the cost of this might transfer onto tenants in the terms of rent in terms of rent increases, and that would essentially be asking a lot of people that already don't have enough money to pay rent in a lot of cases to be funding a just transition toward a greener housing stock. We are also concerned about the way that affordable housing is sometimes used as a blanket term to include a lot of housing options that don't tend to be genuinely affordable for people on the ground, such as mid-market rent. And we want to see more houses benchmarked specifically toward council or social housing. We also want to emphasize that. That was it for me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. All right. That's great. Thank you very much for those contributions. Anybody else? Callum would like to come in as well.
Thank you. Firstly, just to come back up what Nicola is saying, and she's absolutely right. You know, developers are reticent to build, landlords are reticent to build with building costs right now. I know a number of consortial landlords who are hedging their sort of wait to hoping to next year to building costs and the core costs will come down. But Nicola's absolutely right. We have no guarantee. There's a hope, but not an expectation that that will be affordable. And the kind of points made earlier, if we continue to delay building enough time that it's going to be more affordable, we're going to find it ever difficult to catch up and build, 110,000 affordable homes by 2032. But Another kind of more substantial point I wanted to make was around actually where the homes are getting more expensive because we have increasing expectations and standards on homes. And that's important, that we shouldn't look at this as a bad thing. This is positive. We want to see more energy efficient homes. We want to see greater space standards. We want to have more digital connectivity. We want to have housing for varying needs so people can live and life to them. So these are really, really positive. So we shouldn't look at these as a negative facing sector. It's just about the balance of where all these things are paid for. Whether this comes from tenant rents, whether we're going to see tenants pushed into increasing unaffordability, or the money comes from the state. And that's ultimately the choice for politicians to make about where that comes from. But the direction of travel is correct. We should see increasing standards in the entire renting sector, and the government's approach, the whole renting sector strategy, kind of leans in that direction. So let's be positive about the new standards that we're seeing and that we're looking to develop for the kind of renting sector. But we also need to reflect on actually where the balance comes from, because Tony's right, we have seen social tenants paying more and more in social rent, so particularly over the last few years. That will only increase unless we see an increase in the £3.5 billion from the government. Thank you.
Thank you, Callum. All right, we're going to move on to explore our fourth theme, which is planning. It's around the National Planning Framework 4 and local place plans, which we already touched on a little bit. I'm going to explore this theme. So the upcoming National Planning Framework 4 is a vital opportunity to underpin and encourage public-led planning, which benefits people and the planet, and ensure that national development fulfill climate biodiversity criteria. So I realize this might be difficult to answer without having seen a draft, but I'm interested to hear if there are any policy areas or aspects which you would expect to see in the National Planning Framework 4, which you think will merit particular parliamentary scrutiny. And I'd like to direct this question to Craig and then Claire.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I wholeheartedly agree with you that the National Planning, the fourth National Planning Framework, is a real opportunity. I think it should be seen as a document which can be a bit of a game changer, which could be transformational in how we live our lives, essentially. In terms of the issues that should be tackling, I think from what we've seen so far from Scottish Government, there are some good noises coming out and a good and clear direction of travel, particularly around using planning and the National Planning Framework as part of the green recovery, about the importance of embedding net zero into the planning decision-making process and using the National Planning Framework to do that. I think also issues around health inequalities, active travel, and issues like that quite strong in the drafts and the consultation documents we've seen so far. I think as part of this, we've been saying that one of the things we should be doing is trying to make sure the National Planning Framework embeds a new purpose of planning about being in the long-term public interest, which should be the starting point for it as well. I think there's some issues in terms of almost process for the National Planning Framework and delivery, which we need to look at. In terms of sort of process and positioning, we think the National Planning Framework should be seen as much more of a corporate document within Scottish Government, a much more influential document, something which is at the heart of the decision-making process and policy in terms of investment as well. We've been calling it should be like a First Minister's document. We've seen that work in other countries such as Ireland, where the Taoiseach has led on that. There's been a clear link to the Treasury. So I think this idea of having this as an influential document is really quite important. And that relies upon the National Planning Framework policy element being very, very clear and providing strong policy direction and trying to minimise any opportunities for wriggling out of different things, but trying to make sure we've got a clear idea what's needed, what's required and what should be done. And I think the other thing about which is really important about the National Planning Framework is we need to shift it from being a document which is essentially about a vision to a document which is, yes, about a vision, but also how you deliver that vision. So we've been arguing for the need to link the vision of the National Planning Framework into a capital investment programme. They do this again in Ireland with the National Planning Framework, where they've got a 20-year vision for the National Planning Framework and a 10-year capital investment programme attached to it, which therefore puts your money in your mouth, so to speak, as well. So that idea of vision and delivery coming together is incredibly important. And we need that. We need that strength of policy. We need that delivery if we are going to try and tackle these big ticket issues, which the National Planning Framework can look at, as I've mentioned earlier, such as zero carbon and the green recovery.
Thank you. And Claire?
Thank you. Where do you start? I could say a lot about the National Planning Framework. Partly this is because we're part of the Planning Democracy is part of the Scottish Community Alliance, and we've had workshops around the National Planning Framework because we see how important it is. But also I'm convener of the Scottish Environment Link Planning Group, and we have had several workshops around this and talked a lot about it. And if I can provide the committee with our the link position statement response as well, which was quite a comprehensive document. But I think in terms of priorities, I guess the language needs to be clear about what we want to achieve. In the past, it's very much been framed around development, enabling and sustaining economic growth. And planning has been seen as a means of delivering government economic strategies. But if we're going to move to a well-being economy or a green recovery, I think we need to decouple from this old language of growth. However you embellish it with terms and adjectives around sustainability and inclusivity, it's still a growth model, and we need to accept that constant growth is just not possible on a finite planet. And if we're going to deliver on net zero, we need to demonstrate clear progress on well-being targets, not growth targets. So we've seen a trend where increasingly any development has become synonymous with the public interest because it contributes to growth. But not every development that contributes to growth is in the public interest. So we need to meet strict criteria for development to be in the public interest and be prepared to say no to development that isn't. And commitments to climate and biodiversity net gain all hinge around sort of difficult decisions on this, and it will be difficult. Currently, we have a system of allocating land for housing that is remarkably inefficient. We're expecting a lot of our housing to be delivered by the private sector, which is where, the public-led planning is coming in now. We're hoping to see a lot on public-led planning in the document, because that allows a more targeted use of land, which is much more efficient and much more climate-friendly, and will enable planning authorities to actually deliver on affordable housing. As Craig was saying, it needs to be a delivery document. We welcome, the proposed Edinburgh City Plan, because that actually kind of showed the problems, about delivering on affordable housing, that 60% target, and how difficult they were going to find that to achieve, even when they're going to allocate lots of land for affordable for housing. They said that the city plan allocates more land than the combined requirement for markets and affordable housing to allow affordable housing to be provided through the delivery of market housing. And essentially what they're saying is less land would be required if we're not solely relying on the public sector to deliver it. So public-led planning, it's much more proactive. It allows planners to determine what sites are best and the most sustainable sites. So it offers a much more democratic model, which will fulfil commitments to placemaking. So we'd really welcome stuff on that. If you'll give me a minute, I just also want to talk about 5-year effective housing land policies, because there's currently a massive complexity around this this area. The language around housing land policies is utterly impenetrable to communities. You need to swallow a dictionary as terms, housing supply targets, housing land requirements, presumptions in favour of development that contribute to sustainable development. I mean, it's a bit nuts. And we've even had to write a guide which is 40 pages long to explain to communities this one particular policy area. And the language and the calculations and the details are driven by the fact that the development industry absolutely benefit from it being so complex. The litigation on 5-year housing supply by the development industry is massive over the past 5 years, and it requires detailed knowledge only a handful of lawyers can understand. Even the Scottish Government have had to be careful in the wording of their policies on five-year effective housing land supply, which, as we've seen in the recent mischief created by the serial court challenges to Scottish planning policies on housing by developers. Even despite that careful wording, you know, the government still lost the most recent challenge. And we think this can be resolved, this problem can be resolved by the change in approach to housing land allocation and through a public-led planning approach. You know, there's no problem providing land for the market demand, but what we're not doing is providing land for outwith the market. And so we need to allocate land for just social housing. We need to allocate land for affordable housing, you know, community-led housing, self-build and cooperative housing, and rather than housing as a whole. So there's that. Finally, have I got a minute just to on local place plans?
Okay, yeah. Yes, I was going to actually do a supplementary on local place plans. So, yes, if you
do that. I'll come back to you on local place plans.
No, if you just go ahead.
I just wanted to say that, you know, local place plans put enormous responsibilities onto community shoulders. But these, you know, this should be accompanied by rights. You know, if they're going to spend so much effort drawing up these local place plans, you've got to provide some sort of assurances for communities that they cannot be undermined by speculative developments that are not in the plans and not in the public interest. So we want communities to be empowered. They need to be able to trigger public interest tests, and they should be given a right of appeal. We're still asking for a right of appeal for planning decisions that go against democratically agreed local place plans. Just quick word on nature networks. Just as a national developer, I said I had a lot to say. National Nature Network is a national development. Please, we'd welcome your support for that.
Okay.
Sorry to go on.
Thank you, Claire. Okay, so we're going to move on to our next theme. Just in the interest of time, you see, we could spend a whole day or a week together with all of these conversations. So the next theme that we're going to pick up on is net zero emissions. And I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin, I hope, if he's online, our committee member. Mark, are you there? Great. Okay. Over to you.
Yeah. Thanks, Kavina. As the Commissioner said, I wanted to touch on the theme of net zero. And can I ask a kind of broad question to the members of the panel that are joining this morning, just to ask their views on the adequacy of the Scottish Government's plan to meet the net zero carbon emission target, and perhaps a more specific question as well, as we're looking at targets to remove carbon emissions from heating systems by 2025. Just what kind of certainty the sector have, because I mean, I guess some of the sites that have been identified for purchase and development right now as we edge into 2022 will need to be these sites that have zero emission heating systems plans right now. So I don't know, perhaps I could direct that question firstly to Nicola Barclay.
Thank you very much, Mark. Happy to answer that question. Yes, this is something we are working actively on just now, as building standards consultation on Section 6 is live. The consultation is open till the end of October, and we're working with members to make sure we put in a really helpful response to this really important topic of net zero. We have known for a while that we'll be moving towards air source heat pumps or other non-gas type of heating systems in homes, and the industry is working towards that. And in fact, many of our members are already putting in alternative supplies of heat to the homes they're constructing today. The concerns we have, and I don't want to preempt our response, and I'm happy to share our response, the consultation with the committee once it's been finalised, but the main issues that we have is that there's a supplementary step change being proposed, which would come into effect next year, is kind of a step in the journey towards net zero, which means fundamentally we have two large changes to building regulations in the space of 4 years, which is very difficult when you are buying land for a 3 to 5 year build programme. How are you how are you appraising your land now if you don't know what your what standards you're going to be building to, how much that's going to cost to build each house. So there's a lot of kind of interesting issues arising just because of the timescales. One of the other things for the record is that we rely on software that calculates the SAP ratings of homes, and there are technical issues with the software currently, which we are trying to grapple with, along with building standards, fix it. But we need to have a system in place to deliver these homes. So we need software that works. We need a supply chain that can supply enough air source heat pumps for all the homes which we hope to be building. We also need to have people trained up to maintain, to fit, this new style of equipment. But we also need consumers to understand what this equipment is, how it heats their home slightly differently than a gas boiler, which many of us are used to. So there are a number of kind of dominoes in effect that we need to kind of knock down in order to get to that net zero. And I do have concerns just now that many of these things are still challenges which we haven't yet been able to overcome. But as I say, we're working with building standards. I sit on their resilience group, and we are really keen that the industry works with government to get to these net zero targets, but in a way that is deliverable for everybody and brings the supply chain, brings the consumers along with us.
Okay, thank you. Come to Craig McCartan and then Callum.
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to make the point about we need to, although the housing unit itself is a really important part of this, I think one of the things that's been missing, certainly out of the last version of the Climate Action Plan that I saw, was the recognition about how we need to try and change how we use our places and how we design our places as well. The built environment has an enormous impact on how we travel, on transport patterns as well, and we need to try and factor that into that and make the most of that. But the last version of the Climate Action Plan that I saw only had a page on planning in place, and I think there's a real demand there. Particularly transport emissions are a significant part of our emissions. We're trying to see how we can make that work and make that much more important as well. So just a call for that, and as part of that, I think, going back to the discussion around the National Planning Framework, I think that means we need to rely upon some really, really strong policies which give confidence to planners, to councillors, to reporters in the Department of Planning and Environmental Appeals to make these decisions so they're backed up and taking that all forward as well. And it perhaps makes me think that one thing we need to think about as well is measuring the success of planning just now tends to focus on how quickly you process a planning application. In many ways, that is important. But I think now, given the particular demands of zero carbon, we perhaps need to think more about how we measure the success of planning by the outcomes we achieve on the ground, being at zero carbon and sustainable places as well.
Thank you for that.
Thanks, Kate.
Sorry, I'm not sure who's doing the leading there. Maybe. So I think that we want, Callum wanted to come in, Stacey, and then Tony, and then I think we're going to have to move on to the next theme.
Thanks, convener. I just wanted to make a quick point around, absolutely, we want to ensure that the homes of the next generation are built to a net zero standard, but the big challenge is going to be resistant stock. In 20 years' time, the stock that we see today is going to be the majority of stock we still have. The challenge is, how do we fund that? How do we ensure that less so much in the social sector, but principally in the private housing sector, both owner-occupiers and private landlords, how do we ensure we are getting funding to them? And that is a tricky discussion and decision about how you leverage money to someone who helps, you know, increase the value of their own home. But that's a decision this government is going to have to face. We need to see the entire housing stock, particularly the private housing stock, improve its energy efficiency. And if we don't, particularly in the private rent sector, the likelihood would be increases in tenant rents. And we've already talked about that with kind of new standards. So there is a point where we're going to have to really leverage significant investment into private housing to ensure we're improving that stock as well as looking at the kind of new stock. I think the fundamental challenge will be on the kind of the existing stock that's there to ensure that it reaches net zero.
That's a great point. And so Stacey and then Tony.
Thank you. I'd point the committee towards the report of the Zero Emissions and Social Housing Task Force, which SFA co-chaired. The report was published last month and looked at not only the issues and concerns for our sector in terms of net zero, but also looking to start to kind of chart some recommendations and a roadmap towards meeting the targets. Some of the key concerns that we did discuss in the group, there, as Callum's kind of touched on, the social housing sector has always been held to higher standards in terms of energy efficiency, and as a result, the homes in the sector are of a much higher standard than other parts of the sector. Obviously, it's welcome that Housing to 2040 is starting to move towards an all-tenure approach in this area, but you know, there's quite a bit to go. And it can't be, you know, even if the social housing sector continues to meet those targets, you know, we are a small part of the overall housing system. So, you know, we really need to focus the efforts on the other parts of the sector that are still a bit behind. And also, as Nicola touched on, in terms of the SAP software that's used, similarly, one of the biggest concerns for our members, and which is reflected in the report of ZEST, is around the second energy efficiency standard for social housing, EASH2. The standard has been a bit of a concern for our members for quite a few years, just in terms of whether it's actually the right thing to do. We published research in partnership with ChangeWorks earlier this year, which found that even if our members invested the sum it would take for the sector to meet EASH2, which comes at a price tag of $2 billion, that investment would only reduce in a 9% reduction in fuel poverty levels for tenants. Which I think by anyone's standards isn't a great return on investment. And you know, it's, members are being asked to make that investment as well as the investment required for new supply as well. So it's quite a heavy price tag for the sector to carry that alone. So one of the key recommendations for this would be to bring forward even sooner the Scottish Government committee to bringing forward the review of EASH2 to 2023, but we think that that's just still even too far away, and we would call on the Government to urgently review that as soon as we can, just so that the sector is clearer on what we are working towards and that we can all be confident that it is the right thing that we're working towards in terms of being able to meet these targets.
Thank you for that, Stacey. And Tony?
I think a couple of contexts, if you like, for this part of the conversation, one of which is that this is, we are told, a climate emergency, and the second one is that our ambition is for a just transition, that nobody should be left behind. And with those two points in mind, I would say that I point out that the private sector is going to be building houses that require to be retrofitted to meet the net zero standard for the next 5 years. The social sector will effectively be building net zero homes universally from next year. So we need to be clear, if this is an emergency and it's a just transition, then what do we mean by that? I think the other point is to pick up on Callum's point about the retrofit agenda, which is the absolute centre of this, and it's where the great costs are. Our estimate is in the local authority sector, retrofitting the existing stock is going to cost something in the order of £5 billion. That's the equivalent of everything the sector spent on capital investment for the last decade, and leaves no space for other programmes, other investment programmes, and puts a serious question mark over the ability to deliver affordable rent. So the Scottish Government has not yet done sufficient to understand the implications of the net zero retrofit agenda. It certainly hasn't allocated enough resources to do it without putting an unbearable burden on the rents of social housing tenants. We haven't got any metrics on what we mean by a just transition, but also we have a huge focus on the social rented sector, which at best probably accounts for about 2% of all Scotland's carbon emissions. You do not have a zero carbon transition for transport. We do not have a zero carbon transition for agriculture. We do not have a zero carbon transition program for industry, but we have one for the homes of the poorest people in this country who are never going to be required largely to pay for that transition. So I think there are serious gaps in the approach that have been taken, serious risks both in terms of fuel poverty and rent affordability for people in the social rented sector, but also a fundamental misunderstanding about what's being involved. For many tenants, this will require substantial changes to their homes. It's not just a matter of swapping out the gas boiler for a heat pump. You're going to have to put water storage back in, hot water storage back into homes where this has been removed for 20 years. It'll mean reorganizing kitchens. In some cases, it means changing layouts. It means losing storage. It means a heating system that functions in a very different way. And I think people have simply underestimated the scale of the disruption that the tenants are facing off the back of this, and as a consequence, don't really understand what they mean by a just transition. If we get this wrong, this will be an attack on the poor in Scotland. And at the moment, I think there is a real risk that we'll get this wrong.
Thank you for that, Tony. That's a very powerful framing, actually, of the situation that we're in. Good to get that perspective. So we're going to move on to our final theme, And I'm going to bring Megan in for that, and that is sustainable communities and placemaking. Megan. They're great.
Good morning, committee and panel. Can I also refer to my register of interests? I'm a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. I'll also try and get through this. I've got a sore throat this morning, so I'll try and get through this without losing my voice. If I could focus on 20-minute neighbourhoods, please. And I would like to hear the panel's views on the practicality of 20-minute neighbourhoods, especially when looking at more rural communities. And if I could start with Craig McLaren, please.
Thank you. Yeah, 20-minute neighbourhoods, I think, again, are a good opportunity to try and think about how we can create more sustainable something, but I think we do need to get beyond this rhetoric which is out there just now. The name's quite a useful handle because I think it gets people to realise the importance of having local services and local infrastructure close to hand. But I think there's a number of things we need to try and do to try and perhaps operationalise the idea or the concept. So there are things already in Scottish Government's armoury, things such as the Place Principle and the Town Centre First Principle, which are very useful principles in trying to set out how you can try and take account of place and take a place-based approach to things and to try and make sure that services are located in our town centres, our village centres and our city centres. The issue with that for me is very much that they are principles and we need there's no real mechanism in place to see how we can be transparently if they're being applied and if not, why not? So I think there's a need to try and see how we can make sure we have a process which allows us to identify what the process has been in the decision and taking decisions on development and asset management, which take account and how they take account of these principles. So there's something in there. I think there's also the broader policy environment and context for this is really, really important. We've heard about local place plans. I think they've got a really important role in this process. We need to make sure they're funded, that they put communities at the front of that discussion and that debate. We've talked already about the National Planning Framework and how a strong policy basis for that can go some way to making sure we get things in place, which make those decisions, which are often difficult decisions, can make them easier to make as well. And I also think there's some real potential in the digital planning strategy which the government's putting in place just now. It's investing £35 million over the next 5 years. And one of the key things that brings, I think, with it is how we can better map data. So spatial data can be a really useful background for helping us to make decisions and to provide evidence and taking forward decision making in 20-minute neighbourhoods as well. You mentioned rural areas, and I still believe the sort of principles of 20-minute neighbourhoods can be applied in a rural in a sort of rural concept. We published some work on this recently. I'd be happy to share with the community, both on 20-minute neighbourhoods and also in rural planning. And the idea is that you essentially there's a hierarchy of things which people need to access. And you should always remember 20-minute neighbourhoods are about trying to make sure you can get your local, your daily needs within a 20-minute walk there and backwards. So that's about trying to make sure we can invest in our rural areas, ensure that they have the local shop where you can pick up your loaf of bread, your pint of milk and the things you need on a local basis. But it's also trying to think about beyond that when you need things which aren't just a local need, but something which is more longer term in its nature. So thinking about the hierarchy of our settlements across rural areas and trying to invest within them so that they might not be within 20 minutes, but they're at least closer to hand and going to the big city to try and get something. So it's how we can invest and try and make sure that our local settlements, hierarchy of those settlements, try and meet those needs. I think that concept is still well and good. For me, the biggest issue with 20-minute neighbourhoods is the retrofit aspect of it. Particularly, I think a lot of the settlements and the extensions and the places were put on at the edge of cities and the edge of towns over the last 20, 30, 40 years, which have been very much just about housing. We need to try and change that model and see that the services provided within that area as well. How you retrofit that is incredibly difficult. I don't have an answer for how you can do that. But when we start from scratch, I think we can see we've got some really good examples. I often quote the Gorbals. It's a really good example of where we have a community which is rich in terms of its housing stock, It's got services and shops aligned to it. It's got a public park. It's got links to public transport. So there are models there which I think we can lean on and learn from.
Thank you.
Nicola, Tony, and then Eleanor.
I think Craig hits on a really interesting point there. What do we mean by 20-minute neighbourhoods? And I was really heartened to hear him describe what it actually means. And I think it's important that we think of MPF4 as an opportunity to start looking at this in a lot more detail and bringing everybody with us. We were talking earlier about the planning system and what MPF4 would be, what opportunities it would bring for us. And in fact, I think it was Claire Simmons was talking about the complexity of housing numbers and five-year housing land supplies. And while developers are very much knee-deep in it, they don't really want to be really focusing on that. So I'm really hoping that MPF4 is going to give us really clear housing numbers that we can then move our energy away from talking about housing numbers. And let's focus our energies on place creation. Because at the moment, so much energy is kind of drawn into the into that argument about housing numbers. Let's get a good solid number in the plan and move on. One of the key things I really have concerns with, and I think this is probably with a slightly different hat on than my Homes for Scotland one, but I think it's important, again, for people to consider, is the gender and diversity issues that 20-minute neighbourhoods might bring, the challenges there. Alan mentioned earlier about women and the homeless agenda. We have to think about women and the idea of walking 20 minutes in the winter, in the dark, leaving your kids at home, or if you're a caregiver. We don't have a level playing field here of who is walking within a 20-minute neighbourhood. We have an elderly population as well. So I think we just need to be really careful that we bring everybody with us when we're talking about what 20-minute neighbourhoods actually mean. I, for one, would not walk out of my house in the winter, in the dark, go and get a pint of milk. I would go in my car because I feel safe. So I think we need to think of this in the round, and it's not just a principle. So let's get beyond the rhetoric. Let's show examples of what this actually means and how do people use our spaces and how safe do they feel in them. So there are many reasons why people use their cars, and safety shouldn't be disconsidered or I think what the word is, should not be dismissed as a non-green way of transport. People do it because they feel safe. I'll stop there because I know there's others wanting to come in.
Thank you, Nicola, for raising that point. Tony and then Eleanor.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question that 20-minute neighbourhoods are a useful idea, a useful concept, but I think we need to also acknowledge that this is not just about shops and bus stops. It's also about the way in which public services are delivered, and we've been through an extended period in which public services have been retreating from and withdrawing from being located where people live and moving away from being reachable, being able to walk to them. So are we talking about neighbourhoods that have a 20-minute walk to a library? Are we talking about neighbourhoods that have a 20-minute walk to a swimming pool or a sports facilities or to a community centre or even to a council office and schools and nurseries? My GP used to be a 5-minute walk away. It's now a 25-minute walk away. The A&E service around here used to be a 5-minute drive away. It's now a 25-minute drive away because it's been centralised somewhere else. Our services have been moving away from the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods because they've been trying to centralise and concentrate because of the pressure on resources, because of the pressure on the money available to deliver them. And we need to think again about the money we invest in our services in order to make this work. It isn't just a matter of better lighting, cycle paths, and a shop just around the corner. It's a much more complicated debate from that. And actually, it requires an increase in investment in public services to make them more accessible.
Thank you, Tony. And Eleanor,
anyone else? Hey, thank you. I would like to reiterate like what Tony just said around like the 20-minute neighbourhoods does not only mean kind of shops, but also will need a sustained funding in public services and local amenities across the board. Living Rent would also like to stress that this, like the idea of 20-minute neighbourhoods obviously would involve a lot of planning happening on the local level. And this needs to be a democratic consultation with local communities so that a 20-minute neighbourhood actually addresses the issues and the shortcomings of the communities where people live. And it cannot be something that is brought down onto people. Like, I think it has to be, as we said, something where people are engaged and brought along to make sure that certain communities and certain people are not left behind. We would also like to highlight that the 20-minute neighbourhood should include like a very locally oriented use of derelict land and vacant land in communities to ensure that especially sites that have formerly been used for social housing can be brought back into a green transition. We'd also finally like to highlight that a lot of the times increased investment in local communities has a direct effect on rent levels. That oftentimes can push communities out of their it can push people out of their communities. Really like to see this being considered in a holistic way, thinking about how we can keep rents down in areas that are receiving obviously well needed investment, and we would like there to be a consideration of rent controls, as has been and is suggested for the next housing bill, to be kind of properly localised and able to address it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And I'd like to bring in my committee colleague, Willie Coffey, for some supplementary question.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everybody. I lost quite a bit of the discussion earlier. Apologies for that, and if I retread any old ground. I just wanted to pick up on this theme, if I may, and just ask for the panel's views on the sense that our town centres particularly need to be much more than they are at the moment if we're to be successful in delivering this concept of place and sustainable community and safe and pleasant environments and so on. It's just to get your views on this. Now, if a town like Kilmarnock that I represent, there's a number of properties, shops, pubs, buildings, pieces of land that are effectively abandoned by their owners and overgrown with weeds and posters stuck to windows and stuff like that. Does this issue, in your view, play a part in this whole concept that we're trying to achieve here? And if it does, what can we do about it to try and overcome that particular problem, do you think? I wonder if maybe if Craig or Tony have a view initially on that aspect of it, please.
So let's
come in.
Go ahead, Tony, and then we'll have Craig and then Claire.
I hope you'd let Craig go first, but that's fine.
Sorry.
I think there is a substantial problem of empty and semi-derelict and neglected buildings in many town centres and city centres across Stirling, across Scotland. I mean, there's no question about that. I mean, I actually live next door to four empty properties, and they've been empty for the better part of 30 years between them. And I mean, right next door, there, through that wall, just there, lying empty for 30 years, to a perfectly decent house. The powers that exist in the public sector to deal with neglected or abandoned or empty properties are simply not strong enough, and we allow too much credence to the idea that owners have a right to enjoy their property in any way they see, and not enough in the public interest in ensuring that buildings, an important resource in our urban areas and in rural areas as well, are brought back into use and brought back into use effectively. And I think it's just a matter of being clearer about how much of that we're prepared to tolerate, and giving local authorities the powers and the resources to intervene. I think part of the problem is that not all of these buildings have obvious uses that you can put to them. And some of it is about being realistic and a little bit hard-nosed about the point at which a building needs to simply be removed and you need to start again. But I think the principal problem is that we allow owners to neglect and leave buildings lying, we're not sharp enough and quick enough and well enough resourced to intervene quickly and say, no, sorry, this isn't acceptable. We need to bring this back into use. And I stay in Stirling. I can take you through around whole streets in the city centre where most of the upper floors have simply been abandoned for a very long period. Buildings that were sold out the public sector 25 years ago that are still lying empty and undeveloped. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, I just think we need to take a harder line on these issues and be clearer about the powers and the resources available to bring them back into use. We can't afford to have buildings, you know, going back to the carbon agenda, there's substantial embedded carbon in these buildings. We can't afford to have buildings lying empty whilst we build others to meet certain uses whilst these lie empty. And we just need to be a bit more direct about it.
Thank you for that, Tony. And if we could have a quick, brief contribution from Craig and Claire, that would be great. We need to wind up because we've got another panel beginning shortly.
Yeah, happy to come in. I will be quick. I agree with what Rory said. I think there is an issue with place blindness between landowners, some of whom are nowhere near where that property is. And although they'll have leased it out for 25 years to an organisation which has subsequently been bust or moved out, they're still getting an income, so they don't really care. So we need to try and make sure that place blindness goes and we deal with that. There are perhaps opportunities through compulsory purchase order, compulsory sales orders, which have been developed. We need to change the culture and how we use that as well. And the final point I would make is that what we need to also look at is and realise is the solutions and the challenges of a particular town centre or a particular area don't all lie within it. Some of the things which are outside of it actually can have a real impact on it as well. I'm thinking particularly around out-of-town shopping, out-of-town retail parks and whatever. And I need to try and make sure we can get the investment into the town centre rather than a retail park or something which is sitting out at a motorway junction.
Thank you for that. And briefly, Claire?
Yes, just to say we support what Tony was just saying, but also the recommendations in the report commissioned by Aileen Campbell, A New Future for Town Centres 2021, which makes specific calls for National Planning Framework to strengthen the role of town centres and introduce a moratorium on greenfield sites and out-of-town centres. Outstanding
developments. Great. Okay. Well, thank you so much for that. And we're going to have to close there. As I said earlier, it clearly is something that we could spend a lot of time getting into more detail. And I think I'm really taking away, and I'm sure my colleagues are, that planning, getting the National Planning Framework for right is going to be a very important piece of it. But also clearly the issues around house building, supply chain skills, that kind of thing, as well as many other things, including this big question that seems to hang around everywhere: what is affordable? So thank you so much for joining us this morning, and I now suspend the meeting. The third item on our agenda today is an evidence session on six instruments on changes to local authority electoral boundaries in council areas containing inhabited islands. The council areas concerned are Corlea, Nan and Ilan na Nyar, Orkney Island Council, Shetland Island Council, Highland Council, Argyll and Bute Council, and North Ayrshire. Boundaries Scotland has reviewed the ward boundaries within these local authority areas and published reports containing their recommendations for alterations. The Scottish Government has, via the instruments we are considering today, presented the recommendations for parliamentary scrutiny. And I would like to welcome John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Maria McCann, Head of Elections Team, Kenny Pentland, Senior Policy Officer of Elections, and Craig McGuffey, who's joining us virtually, who's a Scottish Government lawyer. We're going to take evidence from the Deputy First Minister before moving on to a formal debate on each of the six instruments in turn. And I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement on the draft regulations.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. I'm pleased to be here today to present the electoral arrangements regulations for the six council areas which contain inhabited islands. The regulations give effect to the proposals submitted to me by Boundaries Scotland, and I have a legal duty to lay them before Parliament. The Scottish Elections Reform Act 2020 removed ministerial discretion to reject or modify the Commission's proposals. Instead, the decision to implement Boundaries Scotland's proposals rests entirely with Parliament. It is vital for local democracy and for local service delivery that councils are as representative as possible of the communities that they serve. Regular reviews of council wards and councillor numbers are necessary to ensure they reflect changes in population. These reviews have been held under the Island Scotland Act 2018, which offers additional flexibility, allowing Boundaries Scotland to create wards that elect one or two councillors in wards which contain inhabited islands, as well as the two, three, four or five councillor wards permitted elsewhere in Scotland. I am aware of the opposition of Highland Council and Argyll and Bute Council to some aspects of the proposals, and that their representatives have asked this committee not to recommend approval of those instruments. There will, of course, be differing opinions on the final recommendations. However, I am pleased that we have heard that in almost every case the consultation process was meaningful and elected members and communities, for the most part, felt their voices had been heard. I am confident that Boundaries Scotland have discharged their duties competently and professionally. There would need to be very strong reasons for rejecting their recommendations. I hope these comments are helpful, and I would, of course, be very happy to answer any questions that members may have.
Thank you very much. Yes, we do have a few questions. So I'll get started with a theme around the Boundaries Scotland recommendations. And just interested to hear your views on whether reducing council representation in remote rural areas such as the North and West Highlands, what do you think about that? Would it be detrimental to our repopulation efforts?
I think the issues are, of course, related, because one of the fundamental considerations that statute requires Boundaries Scotland to adhere to is the question of electoral parity between different localities. But the other principal pillar of the framework that statute requires is, of course, that Boundaries Scotland take due account of locality. And I think on the question of parity between the population composition of wards, obviously the more sparsely populated an area is, the greater the amount of land, and the degree of rurality that will have to be considered as part of those settlements. And there is, frankly, no easy answer to that. I suspect the challenges of representing a large geographical area are now, I suppose, different. Nowadays, I represent a large rural area. I find that approach different now in the light of the pandemic, because, after 23 years of representing the communities I've represented, I'd never had a single video conference call with a single constituent I represented now and doing it every week of the year. So, and it suddenly dawned on me that it's actually more convenient for my constituents in many cases to have that conversation with me remotely than having to travel endless distance to see me or me to see them. So I think there are ways around that challenge. Now, obviously, you asked me, Convener, a very significant question, which is about the repopulation of sparsely populated areas. And I do think that is a policy objective in its own right, which carries merit and which should be reflected in the decisions that are made by Parliament in relation to the composition of wards, where the population volume merits that in applying the statutory principle of parity amongst wards.
It's almost something about, you know, where we lose representation in these areas, then there isn't a person to advocate for, you know, public services and that kind of thing. And it seems to me that, you know, as we, certainly with the case of Highland, if we push towards Inverness, then we would, you know, lose those voices and, you know, and lose the infrastructure, both in people and services, as well as roads and so on and so forth, that would actually encourage people to come back and live in those places.
I think there are different ways of looking at that question. You know, fundamentally, I think that's a duty on the whole of Highland Council to think about those issues, as it is a duty on the Scottish Government to think about those issues and to take policy decisions that support the repopulation of these areas. I'm not certain that the composition of the council and the decisions that are taken about that point necessarily lead to questions around the availability of public services in particular localities. Those are decisions for Highland Council, NHS Highland, the government, various other public bodies, who should be taking decisions because of the strategic importance of the repopulation question, to be able to be advancing those questions, rather than seeing this being repopulation being driven by the nature or the arrangements for electoral representation in a locality. I think it would reflect pretty badly on any public authority if they weren't taking the steps that could be taken to support repopulation if that was one of the policy objectives.
Thank you. It's interesting what's come to light in a way in our work taking evidence that it seems that there's a common factor between Highland and Argyll and Bute. North Ayrshire aside, they were very happy with the outcome, but with both Highland and Argyll and Bute, you had a council that's got a large mainland and islands. And one of the things that's been coming up as a question is around the fact that it seems that remote rural areas on the mainland are facing the same challenges as island communities, and should remote mainland areas therefore be treated this in the same way when changes in democratic representation are being decided?
I think there's an interesting question about that, because I'm struck by the fact that there are mainland areas that have in many respects some of the same characteristics as islands. If I think about the Rannoch area that I represent in Highland Perthshire, it is essentially it is an island on the mainland. There is one route into the Rannoch area and one route out. The other end, well, that was a way out, but it's a long walk, not for the faint-hearted either. So essentially, that route in is not dissimilar to accessing an island through one particular route. So there are similarities there that perhaps need to be reflected upon, and obviously it's within Parliament's scope to ensure that statute reflects that important point. But in the nature of the statutory framework within which Boundaries Scotland represent, I come back to the point I made in my first answer, Convener, which was that there are two pillars to the analysis that Boundaries Scotland undertake: the question of parity and the question of locality, where I do know Boundaries Scotland attach very significant importance to maintaining the cohesion that one would ordinarily think should be in place in relation to the nature of localities.
Thank you. We're going to continue with the theme, and I'm going to bring in Paul McClellan with a couple of questions.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy First Minister. It's really just expanding on the Islands Act that the convener mentioned about there, and obviously the intention of the Islands Act was to empower island communities. And it's really just some of the feedback we got from Highland Council, for example, was around about the reduction of representation on islands such as Bute and Skye. And it was really just to get your thoughts and views on that particular issue.
I think the questions that the Boundaries Scotland have got to wrestle with are essentially questions that are driven by what I think the committee has heard from Boundaries Scotland are internationally strong practices about the nature and the configuration of electoral wards. And Boundaries Scotland need to apply those considerations about, principally around the question of electoral parity, with a sense of understanding of the geographical entity and community with which they are that they are addressing and considering. So I think what's important is that as Boundaries Scotland undertake that work, they engage substantively with local communities. I'm satisfied that Boundaries Scotland have done that to good effect. I think their ability to do so in the Highland Council provisions might have been enhanced had there been greater cooperation with Highland Council. But in the other local authority areas, the committee has heard for itself feedback from those communities about the value of the dialogue that was facilitated by the approaches that were taken. So I think it's important that we listen, the Boundaries Scotland listens carefully to the feedback from island communities, recognises the distinctive characteristics of those island communities, and of course in a number of the proposals that have come forward, that the local communities are very satisfied with the arrangements that have been proposed.
Thanks for that. The next question really is a bit more specific, and it's around about Arran. And Arran's going to be the only one member ward in Scotland, and it takes up 46% of, say, the council's landmass. So it's really just to get in your view on that specific issue in Arran.
I think that's a pragmatic proposal brought forward by Boundaries Scotland. In some of my wider responsibilities, I've, for example, since the government was formed in 2007, I've chaired the Convention of the Highlands and Islands, which of course includes a North Ayrshire Council because of Arran and Cumbrae, which are part of the... certainly Arran is part of the territory covered by HIE. Now, the importance of viewing Arran as a distinctive entity was a point successfully advanced by North Ayrshire Council within the Convention of the Highlands and Islands and in a whole variety of other policy forum, where they acknowledge that there is a very specific set of issues affecting that community around the delivery of public services on the valid questions the convener was raising with me, which are fundamentally about the delivery on Arran, the maximisation of the connections between public services and the important connections between that community and the accessing of public services on the mainland. So I think what Boundaries Scotland have proposed, I think, is an approach reflective of the nature of that island community, recognising its distinctiveness, how so much of life is interlinked within that island and has, frankly, very little to do with what's happening on the mainland, but crucially provides an advocacy role for a representative of that island to advocate for the connections between the island of Arran and the mainland. So I think that's an example of where Boundaries Scotland have looked very carefully at the distinctive circumstances and have come up with what is, as Mr. McLennan fairly puts to me, a unique proposition.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. I'm going to move over to Eleanor Whittam to introduce a new theme.
Thank you and good morning, Deputy
good morning.
First Minister. I'm looking to explore how Boundary Scotland calculates total and ward councillor allocations. So the first question I have is, what are the benefits of having similar voter to councillor ratio across all wards in the same council area? Would having variations in the councillor voter ratio impact on effective and convenient local government as well? Thank you.
I think the first point is to recognise, and Boundary Scotland have made this point to committee, that the question of parity of electorate is not a uniquely Scottish context. It's a well-established international principle in relation to the design of electoral areas. So that principle, given its international standing, is one that I'm not surprised has been a consistent part of the statutory framework that supported the Boundary Scotland since its conception in 1973. So the arrangements flow essentially from that, the application of that principle. But of course, that principle is not applied in an absolute sense. We do not have anything like identical provision between individual wards. So there is an attempt to try to get to what I would describe as close to parity as possible, but in some circumstances that cannot be achieved because of the geographical factors that may prevail through population sparsity, for example, or which might prevail when we take into account the essential element of the connections between communities, which is the other principle under which Boundary Scotland operates. So I think it's an understandable and characteristic of our electoral arrangements, but I don't think it could be deployed on an absolute basis because of the variation that will take place between communities.
Okay, and if we can look at it from another angle, the Electoral Reform Society says that there needs to be more emphasis placed on local community needs rather than on electoral parity between diverse wards of the same local authority area. So could I just have your views on that?
I think that's quite a difficult one to resolve because we have taken decisions. If you look at the statute in relation to the parliamentary constituencies as they are composed here in the Scottish Parliament, there are particular arrangements put in place in relation to Ninian and Shire and to Orkney and to Shetland. So because of their distinctive island characteristics, that is not applied in any other situation across the country. So there will be a place where specific measures of that nature can be put in place. Indeed, the point that Mr. McLennan puts to me about Arran is an example of how that has been deployed by Boundary Scotland. So it will, there will be arrangements that require us to have electorates of a variation in size because of that factor of locality. But if we do that in all circumstances, then we will create really varied parliamentary constituencies or local authority wards, and I think that's a situation that I think is quite unsustainable, given the necessity for us to ensure that Parliament or a local authority is representative of the area that it is designed to be representative of.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. And now we're going to move on to a new theme, and I'm going to invite Miles Briggs to bring that.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, right. Deputy First Minister, and to the panel. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to the consultation process, specifically given the COVID-19 pandemic that we've had, how you felt that has been conducted. For example, unable to have public meetings directly held. And as we found as a committee, actually, internet access not being wonderful either across a lot of these communities. So I just wondered if you had any views on the consultation process.
I think the Boundaries Scotland will have explained to the committee the specific nature of the consultation process that they took forward. The committee has then also heard testimony from a range of representatives of different local authorities expressing their satisfaction and communities, their satisfaction at the nature of the engagement process. So I'm confident that notwithstanding the challenges of COVID, Boundaries Scotland have been able to undertake an effective consultation process. I've been quite struck in relation to my experience over the last 18 months. You know, up until the election, I had policy responsibility. It was a great privilege for me to have this policy responsibility to nurture the Gaelic language. I undertook a number of extensive stakeholder discussions around the Gaelic language, which included representatives mainly from the remote and rural areas of Scotland. I've got two observations about that. One, connectivity was actually pretty good. I was very pleased with it and we had good conversations. And secondly, I probably encountered and was able to interact more conveniently with more people doing it digitally than if I had got on the road. Now, nothing would have brought me more joy than to go off and sit in community halls in the Western Isles or Northwest Sutherland to conduct face-to-face public meetings. Nothing would have given me more joy. But I probably would have interacted with fewer people if I'd done that than actually undertaken digital dialogue in which I sat at home in Perthshire and there were countless representatives on the line able to interact directly with me for longer periods of time because I didn't have to think about travel time and all the rest of it. So there's swings and roundabouts in all of this, but I'm certainly satisfied that there's nothing I've seen that suggests to me that Boundaries Scotland have done anything other than undertaken an effective consultation process.
Thank you for that. One part which was also highlighted to us was with regard to the island community impact assessments. I just wondered if you could tell the committee, or the panel could tell the committee, what advice did the Scottish Government give to Boundaries Scotland with regards to undertaking these? And is the Scottish Government satisfied that no separate impact assessments were actually required?
On the question of, obviously, island impact assessments that are part of the statutory framework, so an organisation has to consider in their own judgment whether the nature of the approach that they take to the satisfying that statutory requirement. And in that respect, it's a matter for Boundaries Scotland to come to that conclusion. I think given the nature of the work that Boundaries Scotland were undertaking on this question, that inevitably requires them to wrestle with the questions that would be inherent in an island's assessment, because they are thinking about what are the implications of for representation, for the engagement, involvement of members of the community in all of these different undertakings. So I'm satisfied that by the nature of the work that Boundaries Scotland were having to undertake, that they would be able to pursue that framework. And of course, any advice that they would seek from the government on that question would be given within the context of the statutory framework that's available.
Thank you. And just finally, part of the Island Bill, which obviously has led to this review, are you satisfied that we'll be using different boundaries which will have been reviewed for these councils compared to the rest of the mainland, and the principles behind a review which will come forward post-council elections will already have different variations in council wards for these elections if these are approved by Parliament?
Yes. Obviously, if Parliament approves the propositions in front of it, then we will essentially be giving effect to processes that have been originated in the Islands Act, so and that was envisaged by the Act. The Act expressly acknowledges that we may arrive at different arrangements in a community of in certain communities, and it is right to do so. So, if Boundary Scotland consider that point and Parliament approves it, so it's perfectly within the statutory framework for Parliament to do to take those steps and for those arrangements to be in place for the local authority elections. I think perhaps, maybe for completeness, I should say that were Parliament not to approve the regulations, I cannot conceive of how alternative propositions could be put in place in advance of the 2022 local authority elections in any circumstance where Parliament did not approve the regulations as part of this process. I don't think there's sufficient time to do that.
Okay. Thank you for that. And I just want to invite my colleagues that are joining us virtually. Mark Griffin, do you have any questions for the DFM?
Yeah, thanks, Camilla. I mean, the Deputy First Minister's answer leads on to the question I wanted to ask about essentially what happens next. The Deputy First Minister set out this morning and in writing the government's obligation to lay these procedures. I just wanted to ask if what the government's position on these proposals are, whether the government is satisfied with all of them, and what the government's proposed course of action would be if the Parliament chose to reject some or all of those SSIs, what the timetable for revised proposals would potentially be, and whether that would align with a wider review of mainland local authorities.
There's 2 points to Mr Griffin's question. The first point is, what is my view about the individual proposals? And Mr Griffin will know that I'm not a minister that avoids questions, but on this occasion I'm going to avoid that question because statute expressly takes ministers out of a review role within the process. So I think consistent, because Parliament has decided that, I think it's important that I do not express a view about whether I think one proposal is right or wrong. If Parliament's decided ministers should be removed from a review process, I think I should respect the rationale of that. On the second point of Mr Griffin's question, if Parliament was to reject any of the statutory instruments that are before it, then let me get the sequence correct. If the committee was not to recommend approval, I would obviously look at that particular decision, and I would be likely, in the light of the committee not supporting a statutory instrument, to seek Parliament's leave to withdraw the instruments that the committee was not prepared to support. I think that would be the appropriate step for the government to take. Should that then be the case, it would then be, I would refer the matter back to Boundary Scotland to look again. I think it is unlikely that the process could be undertaken and completed by Boundary Scotland and then for Parliament to consider any revised proposals for Boundary Scotland in advance of the 2022 local authority elections. The Gould principle, which was came into force after the challenges that we faced in the 2007 Scottish parliamentary and local authority elections, recommended that there should be no changes to arrangements within 6 months of an electoral contest. So for elections in early May, that brings us back to essentially November. And, you know, that's about, I hate to tell colleagues how close November is, although they might be feeling it's kind of getting closer from the temperature this morning. There's no way that could be done by Boundary Scotland and completed by Parliament before November. So the examples that Parliament was not to determine would have to be left until after the election. In relation to the impact of that on wider boundaries activities, I would have to consider what other issues that we are putting two boundaries, Scotland, from my recollection, there is some, I'll maybe ask Maria McCann to just give me some assistance here, but I think there is some upcoming work that they're required to do.
Yes, so the position with regard to the local authority reviews is they're now in a rolling programme. So they would plan to carry out reviews in batches of probably about six, because that seems to have worked well. And one of the real benefits of the rolling programme, which has emerged and which has been mentioned both by the Boundaries Commission and by some of the authorities, is the ability to have better consultation and better interaction. So that's been positive. They also have responsibility for the Scottish Parliament boundary reviews, and that work will commence in 2022. So they're currently looking at the programme for how to take forward both responsibilities, and obviously if they have to do further work on any of the reviews which are before you, then that would have to be programmed in as well.
Okay, I think that concludes our questions. Thank you. Oh, we've got one more from Elena.
Thank you very much. We did have a lot of responses coming in to our call for views, quite a significant number. And I just want to explore a couple that have come in relation to Highland and also to Argyll and Bute. So in her submission to us, Margaret Davidson, who's the leader of Highland Council, stated that we are strongly of the view that the changes proposed by Boundaries Scotland fails to recognise the specific Highland context, particularly in relation to parity, sparsity, rurality and deprivation, and if implemented would result in a significant democratic deficit for the Highland. We've also had quite a number of respondents from Eilley express concern about their island becoming part of a new island-only Eilley, Jura and Colonsay ward, and Eilley Community Council stated, we believe that the recommendation to reduce our councillors to two and to restrict boundaries to island only would narrow our horizons, risk exclusion from important issues that affect us all, and reduce the collective strength of our voice within Argyll and Bute Council. Could I ask you, Deputy First Minister, if you could respond to both of those?
I think, in responding to those points, that I recognise the importance of the issues that Elena Whittam raises, but I do come back to my point that I answered to Mark Griffin, that where ministers have been taken out of the statutory process, I think it's important that I act in a fashion that respects that decision. I would point out, and I point this out simply to highlight the challenge on these questions, because there's no easy answer on any of these questions. Mr. McLennan put to me the situation in Arran, where Arran seems to be really quite pleased about having an island-only representative who can fight the corner for Arran locally and with North Ayrshire Council and with wider public bodies. The community in Islay is taking a different view to that proposition, and you know, I could sit here and argue the merits of both cases, so I think it highlights the fact that there can be different approaches and different perspectives taken. In relation to the situation in Highland Council, I think what I'm struck by, and it goes back to the exchanges I had with the convener at the outset of her questions about some of the issues in relation to Highland, there is a duty on local authorities, as there is on the government, to take forward the necessary and appropriate policy interventions that meet the needs of individual localities. So it's not, it should never just come down to what is said on a locality's behalf by a local elected member for that locality. It is, how does Highland Council reach all of Highland? How does Highland Council do the right thing by all of Highland, as opposed to we only do the right thing by a particular locality if the voice is strong enough from that locality? That's not representative democracy for me. That's not how you listen to communities and how you respond to the agendas about which they are concerned. So without wishing to give a specific view on the merits of individual proposals, those are the general sentiments that I think public authorities need to be mindful of when they're coming to these conclusions.
Thank you.
Thank you, and I've just heard that Willie Coffey would like to come in. He's joining us virtually. Willie, do you have a question for the Deputy First Minister? He's had difficult connectivity all morning, so I think we might have lost him. We have to move on. You know what his question was? No. Okay, I think we'll have to move on. So there's the converse example of the ones that you were talking about. So I just want to say thank you for responding to our questions, and I think we're going to move on to the fourth item on our agenda, which is consideration of, well, it's the beginning of considering a number of motions. So there's a fourth item on our agenda today is the consideration of motion S6M00961 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Nahilanan and Yar regulations 2021 be approved. Invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
I'd move the motion, Convener, my name.
Thank you. And do any members wish to speak? No? Okay. The question is that motion S6M00961 in the name of John Swinney be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Yes, I think we are. Okay. Okay, we're going to move on to agenda item number 5. The fifth item on our agenda today is consideration of motion S6M00960 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Orkney Islands Electoral Arrangements Regulation 2021 be approved. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
Moved formally, Convener.
Thank you. Any members wish to speak to the motion? No? Okay. The question is that motion S6M00960 in the name of John Swinney be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so far so good. Okay, we're going. The sixth item on our agenda today is consideration of motion S6M00959 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Shetland Islands Electoral Arrangements Regulations 2021 be approved. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. And do any members wish to speak? The question is that motion S6M00959 in the name of John Swinney be approved. Are we all agreed? The seventh item on our agenda today is consideration of motion S6M00974 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Highland Electoral Arrangements Regulations 2021 be approved. Invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to the motion, speak and move the motion.
Moved, Convener.
And do any members wish to speak to the motion? The question is that motion S6M00974 in the name of John Swinney be approved. Are we all agreed?
No.
No. Okay. All in favour of approval of the motion? All against approval of the motion? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and me too. So that's everybody rejecting the motion, and there are no abstentions. Is that? Okay, so that's 0 votes for and 7 votes against and 0 abstentions. We're now moving on to the eighth item of our agenda today in consideration of motion S6M00973 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Argyll and Bute Electoral Arrangements Regulations 2021 be approved.
And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
Move, Convener.
Thank you. Do any members wish to speak to the motion? Miles?
Thank you, Convener. As with the previous vote on Highland, can I start really by putting on record our thanks to Boundaries Scotland? I think it's important to recognise the substantial work which is undertaken. I know from the correspondence I've received, I know all members, that there are real concerns still with regards to what is being proposed for both Argyll and Bute and Highland. And so with that in mind, I would look to reject this set of boundary changes.
Okay, the question is that motion S6M00973 in the name of John Swinney be approved. And I know we're not all agreed, so I'm just going to go to all in favour of approval of the motion. All against approval of the motion? Okay, and there are no abstentions, so that is 0 votes for, 7 votes against, and 0 abstentions. The ninth item on our agenda today is consideration of motion S6M00975 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the North Ayrshire Electoral Arrangements Regulations 2021 be approved. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
Move, Convener.
Thank you. Do any members wish to speak to the motion? The question is that the motion S6M00975 in the name of John Swinney be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The result is that we are all agreed. I'd like to know if members are content to delegate the signing off of the report to myself.
Agreed.
Thank you. And I wish to thank the Cabinet Secretary and your officials for joining us in person for this session this morning. Thank you. And we're going to suspend briefly while the next panel. The next item on the agenda for the committee is to consider two negative instruments as listed on the agenda. The instruments are town and country planning, miscellaneous temporary modifications, Coronavirus Scotland Regulation 2021, and town and country planning, Cairn Ryan border control posts, EU exit, Scotland, Special Development Amendment Order 2021. And I'll just ask committee members, are there any comments? Anybody got any comments? No? Okay. I'd like to ask if the committee has agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to these instruments.
Agreed?
Yep. Okay, great, thank you. And I'm now going to suspend the meeting, close the meeting, so that we can move into private session.